Pop culture has met the microchip, and a strange new creature has emerged.
You've got this convergence of youth culture, technology culture, dance culture, and to an extent drug culture as well, which has become merging in the middle.
At the heart of this techno trip is a drug called ecstasy.
For thousands of years, people have been banging the tribal drum and dancing for 12 hours, and often drugs were involved. Instead of like having a few natural herbs that have been shot up your nostril with a blowpipe, you're getting sort of pharmaceutical things, and instead of the sort of skin over a log for a drum, you're getting electrical sounds.
But the pleasures of rave have their price. Ecstasy can kill.
Your blood clotting goes haywire, your brain begins to dysfunction, and your heart can pack up.
But despite dangers known and unknown, this heady mixture of music, drugs and technology has created a brand new experience.
Club culture for the last 10 years or so has represented a kind of center of energy, and it's either get with it or drown, really, surf or die.
Midsummer in Kent. An airport hangar is being turned into a beach. £250,000 worth of lights will sear eyeballs with lasers and strobes. 100,000 watts of sound will hammer eardrums. 4,000 of the 500,000 who rave every weekend will arrive here in the next few hours. They have come to dance, and only dance. Some may take drugs, many won't. But there'll be no booze, no chatting up, just non-stop dancing right through the night.
One evening, we went. Anxious build up, all that expectancy, that anxiety element, just helping build you up all night, and very excited. And then walking down, huge queues, worries of tensions about whether the bouncer's going to find you, search you, kick you out, because if you're carrying something in. Could hear the noise. We've been queuing up for about 2 hours, and we could hear the noise coming out, really thundering. And we just went in there and went straight up to the top, to the balcony section, and just sort of glanced down, and it was just absolutely incredible. And all of a sudden, I was just taken away. I just completely taken away, and I didn't stop dancing all night.
Rave music has virtually no lyrics or melody. It just pounds the ears with a relentless 4-4 rhythm of up to 180 beats a minute from the moment you enter.
There was just this massive rush of, to me, happiness, because there was a genuine, brilliant atmosphere in the club. And everybody was basically feeding off each other, where everybody's shouting and screaming and dancing.
And all of a sudden, I just had this huge whoosh running through my body. And sort of an out of it sort of thing, don't know where it went, and then a huge energy force almost, and then just going mad again, just dancing again and going crazy.
And this would just build up, and the whole crowd would just be like going along with it, and becoming more and more frantic, until you did actually feel as if you were slightly losing control.
It hits you and it bombards you, and it breaks down any of those barriers that set you between it, so the rhythm sort of just almost grabs hold of you.
I actually came away from that thinking I have just had the best night of my life. I mean, I really thought I have never had a better time. It was just the happiest.
The happiness lasts till dawn and beyond. It all began in 1988, the so-called second summer of love. Late at night, cars full of revelers packed normally deserted motorways. They gathered at service stations and waited for a tip-off. The location of an open field or a disused warehouse. It was all kept last minute to prevent the authorities from getting there first. The police thought they might breach the peace. The kids said they just wanted to dance to a new music called Acid House. But there was one other crucial element. The new dance music arrived at the same time as a new drug called ecstasy. Ravers who took the drug enthusiastically reported that it made them feel warm, friendly to strangers, and want to dance all night. Ecstasy is a Class A drug, which means dealing carries a maximum life sentence. But tens of thousands of doses, made mainly in illegal Dutch factories, are taken every week. And it's thought at least 2 million Britons have tried it. The stepfather of Rave's favorite pharmaceutical lives in the hills behind San Francisco. In the early 60s, Dr. Alexander Shulgin was one of the Dole Chemical Company's top analytical chemists. He turned his skills to making psychoactive drugs. It cost him his job, but turned him into a folk hero to the Rave generation. In the mid-1960s, he resynthesized an obscure drug that had been patented but then ignored by the German company E. Merck in 1911. It was called 3,4-methylenedioxy-N-methylamphetamine, MDMA for short. It would later acquire the street name Ecstasy. To Dr. Shulgin, it was just one of hundreds of mind-altering drugs he concocted and tested on himself and his close friends.
Actually, it's about 40 years ago. I started with a drug that is an isolate from a cactus called mescaline. And it was an eight-hour experience. My curiosity was, if such a simple molecule can allow me this type of openness, this so-called psychedelic experience, what modifications that molecule will modify, improve, change, redirect that type of introspection. And hence that became my research search. Ah, magnificent. This is my first effort to make the product, and I have starting material and product left.
Today in his garden shed laboratory, Dr. Shulgin is synthesizing what he hopes will be a brand new psychedelic substance. In the weeks to come, he will try it in larger and larger doses and assess whether or not the trips it will produce are worth taking.
I rather suspect it would be a visual distortant, maybe color exaggeration, wiggly lines, moving patterns. I would not expect it to rob you of awareness of your reality and where you are and your relationship with it. And the
graph down here. Around 20 years ago, Dr. Shulgin made these careful notes. The first recorded experience on ecstasy.
This is one of the early studies on MDMA. I called it N-methyl-MDA at the time. And let me get my glasses so I can read here. 16 milligrams, that was in 1976. Actually, the first trial in that particular guise was on a train trip going from here to Reno. There was a thing called the Fun Weekend, the Fun Reno Train, and I went with my late wife and two very good friends, and we very often would take our own meals with us, and we'd eat on the train with the fun of having a tablecloth and a candelabra and lox and all the pleasures instead of a sandwich, and not at all uncommon we did then have a martini or an alcohol with as a prelude to dinner, and I asked if they would mind if I tried the chemical in its place. 25 milligrams, no effect. 40, no effect. 60 milligrams, no effect. 81 milligrams, I got a plus one. 53 minutes, smooth shift into a light intoxication. Distinct, almost early alcohol-like intoxication. And I'd find that I would blend very nicely into the gregariousness, into the disinhibition of the cocktail hour. So I looked upon it as a possible low-calorie martini, or no-calorie martini.
Dr. Shulgin mentioned the drug's effects to a therapist friend. He and others were enthusiastic. They felt its ability to induce friendliness and empathy would be ideal for treating people with relationship problems. Dr. Shulgin believes thousands were given the drug, often by qualified practitioners, until it was banned in America in 1985.
Well, this is the second time already.
Okay.
At UCLA's Harbor Hospital, Dr. Charles Grobe is head of child and adolescent psychiatry. He believes ecstasy's reported ability to induce empathy means it still has enormous potential for therapy. After hard lobbying, he has, for the first time, permission from the U.S. government to study the drug's effect on humans.
There has never been a prospective methodological examination examining what, in fact, this drug will do on body physiology and on psychological function.
I'll give you medicine now.
The subject has been given 75 milligrams of ecstasy, about three quarters of a street tab, the largest ever officially sanctioned dose in the U.S.
And then this is some water.
As much water as you can.
Nothing's happening to me yet. Describe it. Yeah, something's definitely happening. Yeah, something's definitely happening. I'm feeling little shivers running down my spine. This is... That's not that bad. Whoopsie, it just came again, yeah. It's something that runs up your spine. Is it a girl? Is it a spider? No, it's just a little feeling. Yeah, I wouldn't like to do a five times table thing, but I won't mind dancing. Yeah, seriously, yeah. Yeah, I could get into loud music right now. Loud music and girls. No, not really. Dancing with girls, yeah. I did the same form earlier, but now I admit to being unhappy a little bit more. But it's because it's cool to be unhappy. There's nothing wrong with being unhappy and depressed and things like that. That's the kind of feeling I've got now. But you don't have to think, oh my God, there's something wrong with you if you're sad. It's cool to be sad. Yeah. I could give politicians a couple of tips. I'd like to meet the Pope right now and share some of my newfound wisdom with him. No, it's just a calm, really just a calm feeling.
About an hour and a half after you took the medicine, you appeared to
peak. Yeah.
Very good. Very good. Excellent. Okay. Well, it's good to hear.
Yeah.
You're feeling comfortable?
I'm feeling comfortable, yeah, because I'm feeling completely calm. Cool, calm, and collected as a former. One doesn't have to see.
From the early reports on the effects of this drug, what appeared to be particularly interesting was its suggested capacity to induce an empathic experience. That is very, very unusual, even perhaps unique among drugs.
How does ecstasy work? What does it do in the brain? Thinking and feeling are the consequences of frantic electrochemical activity in the 10 billion or more neurons or brain cells that cram our skulls. Ecstasy works mainly on one group of neurons, the serotonin system. The center of these cells, their nuclei, are clustered at the base of our brains. From here, long wire-like tendrils or axons spread throughout the brain. These are real axons seen under a microscope. Something similar to an electric current passes down the length of these axons. When it reaches the end, it releases a chemical called a neurotransmitter. This substance jumps from one neuron to the next. They are the brain's internal messengers, and it is these that many psychoactive drugs affect. The ecstasy molecule, because of its shape, forces neurons to spew out large quantities of one particular neurotransmitter, serotonin, or as it's sometimes called, 5-HT.
If you imagine my arm as being a nerve terminal, when this becomes electrically active, it releases 5-HT. And the way, what it then does is to suck all the 5-HT up again. So it sort of dunks it into this cleft, this gap between the terminal and the next cell in the cage, and then sucks it all back up again by kind of vacuum cleaner action. What MDMA seems to do is to reverse that sucking up process and to squirt out 5-HT from the nerve terminal. It's like connecting the hoovering pipe to the wrong end of the hoovering machine. It's squirting out rather than sucking up 5-HT.
In depressed and aggressive people, serotonin release tends to be low. Conversely, when ecstasy forces out large amounts, it seems to cause euphoria in normal people. But many of ecstasy's effects are unknown, and with so many people taking it, scientists at the University of San Diego are urgently trying to understand it better. They have compared the effects of ecstasy and a well-known stimulant, speed, on rats. This box is crisscrossed with invisible infrared beams. Every movement and gesture of the rat is recorded on a computer. Undrugged animals are very curious. They rear up and explore the box. And being burrowing creatures, they investigate holes with great interest. A computer charts an undrugged rat's movements over 15 minutes. Another rat is injected with speed. Ten minutes later, the drug takes effect. The animal becomes far more active. It does what it was doing earlier, but only more so. This was the undrugged rat. Now, 15 minutes of a rat on speed. Ecstasy, like speed, also produces hyperactivity, but of a repetitive kind. These rats stop rearing and looking into holes. They seem stripped of all curiosity. The computer shows the effect of the drug.
When you look at the pattern, the patterns are vastly different. In the MDMA-treated animal, they keep doing the same thing over and over again. It's just a very, very, almost stereotyped pattern of the repeatedly hugging the wall and repeatedly going.
Scientists have recently begun to speculate why ecstasy does this. As the drug forces the release of serotonin molecules, they go to several possible landing sites or receptors. Each of these affects behavior differently. Stimulating one of them, the 1B receptor seems to encourage repetitive behavior. Although ecstasy stimulates all the receptors, the effect of this one seems to dominate. In this way, ecstasy may have found the part of the brain that makes you want to dance.
One basis of the rave phenomenon is the music. It's sort of synchronizing people's behavior to an underlying rhythm. When you move to that rhythm, you essentially do one type of behavior. The demand on your behavior is to do the same thing over and over again. You take the drug that does the same thing over and over again, and it uses it perfectly together.
Some people listen pretty boring, but you're getting such intense pleasure from this dancing that it just, I mean, everything else would just be second best.
You sort of lose track, and the rhythm is very important in enabling you to lose track, because it's something that sort of moves your body. It's not something that you have to concentrate on. You have to click into it and get into the groove of the pattern and relax with it, and that is what's an incredible feeling.
It may be an incredible feeling, but the pleasures of ecstasy are not without their price. This drug can kill. The pleasures of rave have their price. Ecstasy can be very dangerous. It's been found mixed with chalk dust and adulterated with other drugs like speed and LSD.
There are features of the way young people are using this particular drug which are very dangerous. Young people often take it with no information, education as to what the effects are and what they should or should not do. And I'm concerned that young people, often being impulsive, may get themselves into a lot of trouble.
Even when completely pure, ecstasy has dramatic effects on normal metabolism. It switches off the body's early warning systems. And after hours of vigorous exercise, there can be severe overheating. Around 25 die every year.
These people's body temperatures were almost at the region of no return. They need urgent treatment to cool them down, mainly to fill them up with fluids and enable the body to start sweating again. If they aren't treated quickly, well then, two or three things can go wrong. The heart may stop pumping properly, the brain can pack up, and perhaps worst of all and most dramatic of all, the blood stops clotting, and they can bleed from anywhere.
But even more disturbing, there may be long-term dangers which will affect every ecstasy user. This freezer is full of thin slices of squirrel monkey's brain. Dr. George Requarte at the John Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore has uncovered alarming evidence that ecstasy destroys brain cells.
This is the normal distribution of serotonin axons in the brain of a squirrel monkey. This is an animal that was exposed to MDMA a year and a half previously. And you see that there's a marked reduction in the number of serotonin immunoreactive axons in the cortex. And again, this effect, or this loss of serotonin immunoreactive axons, is evident not only in somatosensory cortex, but in a number of other regions of the forebrain of the squirrel monkey. The data we have thus far suggests that MDMA is a highly, highly neurotoxic substance that, if taken even in just slightly higher amounts than the normal dose, could result in this kind of brain injury.
In his study, Dr. Requarte gave the squirrel monkeys the equivalent of just three average street tablets of ecstasy.
Whereas alcohol produces its neurotoxic effect after very high repeated doses, MDMA has the potential for producing neurotoxic effects, at least in animals, after a single moderate dose. Okay, well, let me tell you a little bit about the lumbar puncture, or the so-called spinal tap.
We can't examine our own serotonin systems directly, so Dr. Requarte measured levels of a serotonin byproduct called 5-HIA in the spinal fluid of people who were regular ecstasy users. He found that their 5-HIA levels were 30% lower than normal, powerful evidence that ecstasy damages serotonin axons in the human brain. But are there long-term effects on behavior and mood? Dr. Requarte's study subjects underwent a battery of tests. Serotonin damage should show up as changes in levels of hostility. It did, but not quite as expected.
We might have predicted, indeed would have predicted, that lower serotonin would result in more impulsiveness and more hostility. But in fact, what we found is that people with a history of MDMA exposure, in whom we find low serotonin metabolism, they report less impulsivity and less hostility. So that the direction of the change was also surprising.
Many years later, do you feel a more kind of relaxed and less aggressive kind of person?
Definitely. Because before I would take things so personal, or I'd be more stressed out about everything. And now I think I can just take it a little bit more as it is and how it comes. Mm. I think it has helped you kind of like calm your life down, you know.
What we don't know is what will happen to people as they age. We do know that there are changes in serotonin systems over time, i.e. with aging. And one of the concerns is that if an individual doesn't have the usual amount of backup systems, if you will, because of prior MDMA injury, that if they lack that reserve, aging with age, they may begin experiencing problems and difficulties that they otherwise would not have been subject to.
However good ecstasy makes you feel, it is dangerous. It has killed. But how necessary is it? Can people listen to pounding, repetitive music without any drugs and still be ecstatic? If there is more to the experience than drugs, what is it? The psychology department of Leeds University tried to find out for us. It wasn't easy. Most psychological tests would be impractical in the hot and crowded conditions of a club. A solution. An adjective checklist. Four times during the night, a group of 45 ravers would be asked to mark on a line how much of a particular emotion they felt. 20 adjectives cross-referenced would give a glimpse into their state of mind. There were three groups. Regular ravers on drugs, regulars who weren't, and occasional clubbers as a control. The first finding was unequivocal.
They're having a very good time. They're having a very, very good time. Now, in a sense, we can only assess that by their responses to the positive emotions and by comparing those responses to responses to the negative emotions. And they are, in effect, six times more positive than they are negative.
People having fun usually seek out a specific emotion, excitement in a horror film, sociability at a party. But nearly all 30 regular ravers, whether on drugs or not, marked every positive emotion near maximum. They were energetic and absorbed, excited and sociable, happy in every way.
Emotional responses are consequences, that I feel happy when something good happens, but usually I can say what the good thing is. Somewhat odd thing about what seems to be happening to these people at the club is that the response seems to be without content. It's just good. It's just a massive buzz.
I can never escape as much as I can when I go raving. A really good game of sport, like a really good game of squash or something, is good fun, and you forget about everything else. But nothing else compares to the way you lose yourself on a night out, raving.
They don't want things with a lot of content in. I don't mean content in the sense that it's empty. I mean content in the sense that they have to think about things and understand in any sort of conscious or aware manner. If the music in these sorts of clubs had lyrics, the responses would be nothing like those that we found.
The most striking conclusion was that there was no difference in the happiness level of regular clubbers on drugs and those who weren't. The real difference was between regular and occasional clubbers. Regulars were nearly twice as happy, whether on drugs or not. So the key to enjoying a rave doesn't seem to be the drugs, but how often you go. You learn to like it, and the way you do that is by going again and again. But perhaps most surprising of all, reports of feeling sexual across the board were low throughout the night. They stayed at a quarter of the level of positive feelings, like happiness and fulfillment.
I'm a bit surprised that this large number of young people in their late teens, early 20s, who are relatively scantily dressed, because after all the environment is very hot, very sweaty, and they're all dancing, how low the report of them feeling sexual really are. One possibility, and this is actually borne out by talking to ravers, is that losing the tension, losing the anxiety of wanting to find a sexual partner is something that helps them to be more positive still.
I mean, I thought it was much better than the sex I'd had, because it was just so much happier. It was with just so many people. It was such a good shared experience, that made it much more powerful.
Rave music is unique in Western pop culture. It has virtually no lyrics or melody. Where did such a sound come from? In the beginning was disco. By the late 70s, as the film Saturday Night Fever spawned imitators up and down the country, disco was already unhip. The new sound was coming from the gay clubs of New York and Chicago. Here, soul and funk were blending with synthetic electropop from Europe. Black dance music was being driven by the relentless rhythm of an electric drum machine to create a brand new beat, high energy. DJs began to mix records seamlessly. Songs didn't stop, the beat went on and on. The turntable became a musical instrument as DJs layered sound from one record over the beat from another. House music was born.
That sort of evolved almost from the early days of people taking a record and getting even a voiceover on a record and spinning the voiceover. You know, and like when I used to go to warehouse parties, hip-hop warehouse parties, that's all people used to do, you know, with records and, you know, even getting their own records made of their favourite bits and pieces and shoving it on and spinning it in. British people picked up on it and sort of mutated it and did their own versions of it.
And the British mutation was called rave. An abandoned gas holder in Amsterdam. 1,500 people danced to Europe's top techno band, Orbital. Orbital put the dance rhythms of house music onto the cheap drum machines and synthesizers which hit the high street music shops in the late 80s. Their first hit in 1989 was this track, Chime. It went straight from a four-track tape recorder in their bedroom to the top 20.
Well, it's ridiculous, because like, there I was washing dishes in the pizza restaurant, sort of wanting to talk to the manageress and being a bit nervous about it and having to sort of go up and say, look, I'm down on the rota for working Wednesday, I can't work Wednesday, I've got to go and do Top of the Pops. You know, and it's just that I'm sitting there with my marigolds on saying this, thinking, I said, oh look, I don't think I'll be coming in again after that, I'm going to try and, you know, can I give up work? And they were going, yeah, you know, go for it, we'll get someone else, you know. But if it all goes wrong, you know, you can always have a place back here, and I think it still stands now.
Orbital are brothers Paul and Phil Hartnell. In their London studio, they demonstrate how machines rewrote the rules of Western popular music. For the first time in its history, lyrics, melody, and the human voice were stripped away, and the music was dominated by what machines were good at, repeating rhythmic patterns that could go on and on. Then rhythm met the sampler. Originally intended as a device to electronically recreate the sounds of traditional instruments like violins, techno artists realized they could use a sampler to record any sound they liked and layer it over the rhythm tracks.
Just play the whole, and then we've got that. That was a piece of Equinox once upon a time, but that's been sort of, you know, messed around with within the sampler to make it sound completely different.
Like, you've got the whole 30 seconds of the Equinox thing. You can take out a sort of minuscule little sound and then sort of synthesize that through the sampler. You can then synthesize that sound, so you end up with something that it, you know, like, evolve it into something else.
But techno artists were not satisfied with sound alone. They wanted pictures too. These are images sampled and mutated by a company called Electronic Sound and Pictures, who are proving that rave generation ideas are viable business. This is 29-year-old managing director Graham Brown Martin, and Virgin Interactive Entertainment have just bought a stake worth millions of pounds in his company. ESP have brought digital technology to psychedelia. They have written computer software which is inspired by drug experiences. One such program is Flux.
The point of Flux is very simple. Basically, it turns the CD-ROM drive on the Sega into a CD audio player. As the music plays, it listens to the music and then synchronizes graphics of thousands of different patterns and so on. It's absolutely in sync with the music. I suppose it's come from acquired knowledge, if you like, of the use of substances such as MDMA, and where, so we understand, when people are under the influence of MDMA, they get a certain, it's not really a hallucinogen, but if they close their eyes, patterns emerge, which tend to pulse with the music or triggered by other lights in a club environment. And what we're doing is taking that effect and putting it onto a television screen, so you can have the same effect without necessarily the use of drugs. I mean, it doesn't have any come down, it's non-addictive, but it's an entertaining experience.
And as rave moves into the mid-90s, it has begun to abandon the dance floor. More and more clubs found that after a five-hour dance, people needed a room to relax in. Here, DJs started playing ambient music, atmospheric sounds with little or no rhythm, which people could just sit and listen to. This is the chill-out room. Chill-out sounds were followed by chill-out images. Disc jockeys like Matt Black turned into video jockeys and began projecting surreal collages, a mixture of computer graphics, live TV and home video onto the walls of the chill-out room. These were images without narrative, designed on digital technology to accompany or replicate drug-induced hallucinations. Ravers would no longer exert their bodies. They would exert their minds instead.
Really, we want to turn people on, you know, and get inside their heads. I mean, computers are just generally used in quite boring ways, and we want to use them in more interesting, psychedelic ways. I'm kind of with McKenna and Shulgin on this one to a certain extent, you know, which is, you know, human race needs to kind of evolve its psychic potentials by all means necessary, whether chemical materials, psychedelic computer input, or whatever. You know, I feel it's important. A bit like a psychedelic cinema, a bit like a games arcade, a bit like a normal club and a bit like an art gallery. We want to pump up that visual stimulation to the max, and that's part of what this is about. Also, with the interactive element, we want to lure people in to our world so they can start playing. The best thing is when, you know, someone comes up to you and they're off their face and you give them the control to the CDI and they play with it and they go, this is brilliant, man! And they're still there 2 hours later playing with it, frantically waggling it away, you know. In a way, it's like toys for trippers that we're making. And people can either be into it or not be into it. But, you know, I can just say, well, this is art. Because it is art. I mean, this collection of boxes, you know, if I ramp that up, that's generating 25 abstract electronic masterpieces a second. It's just an art machine, an abstract ambient art machine. And that's one level of justification for it. Yeah? I mean, we're quite into, just as an end in itself, just chilling out and letting the machines get on with it. As like a big up yours to all the people who think that they can tell you what art is. And they haven't got a clue. You know, modern art. I'm quite interested in kind of taking this stuff and, you know, rubbing it in the faces of people who, art critics and so on, who think they know what modern art is, and saying, no, this is modern art.
And pushing techno-creativity even further are the people behind these images, FSOL, the future sound of London. They were acid house pioneers back in 88. Today, FSOL describe themselves as master editors. They suck in the sounds and images that we're all bombarded with into their machines. They mutate and retransmit them. Anything is up for grabs. Street sounds can be turned into music, frames of television into art.
Well, the whole authorship of sound has changed, you know. We carry on sound that we're receiving. I wasn't the girl screaming in the park, you know. That wasn't me. There was a performance there. She did it. Thanks a lot, you know. I took it. Maybe that's what electronic music is about. Maybe that's the way, if you look at the nature of the sounds that we collect, it's basically a very, very cheap way of making yourself look anything but the truth. It's a very clever way of looking, making yourself look like the most cosmopolitan, traveled, interesting, multi-headed individual, you know? We're masters of the machine, and that's all. And machines aren't just made with musical intentions in mind, either. There's machines made which are going to revolutionize television. And if the TV companies don't understand it, we don't have to play it, we'll do exactly the way we've done with radio. We'll go through small cable TV stations and work the peripheries until they realize it and they become addicted to it and they have to have it. Judging from the reactions we get, one of them is impotence. If you're becoming impotent, then you've been listening to FSOL, because we're just some weird illness that seems to be sweeping the country. You know, it comes through TVs, it comes through radios, and it comes through vinyl or art or whatever, you know, and it affects you. You know, we've had stories about guys stopping midway through fornication. You know, that sounds like a pretty good reaction to me, because Christ, I've heard so much about this is the perfect fornication music, baby, you know. Right, I'm not interested in that. Sounds too ordinary to me. Sounds like everybody does that. You know? Everybody makes the perfect f***ing music. Christ, I mean, we're not into f***ing that. You know? We can make people impotent with doing something.
Here today, here in this godforsaken, stinking desert, to join this man, Frank, and this woman, Kitty, in cacophonous matrimony, for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, but not for long.
Rave culture has come a long way from kids dancing in dingy warehouses. Today, it boldly proclaims a belief that technology can be psychedelic and even subversive. In America, rave has climbed comfortably into bed with a revival of hippie values. Here, in a remote part of the Nevada desert, is a gathering of techno-hippies, believers in love, peace, and the microchip. No longer flower-powered, when they plugged their computers into the internet, they found a new generation who wanted to tune in, log on, and chill out. Present to record the event are do-it-yourself broadcasters, a duo called Monk.
We've lived on the road 8.5 years, and this is kind of like a nomadic village. 3 days, it's here, and after 3 days, it's gone. We live on the road. We write about life on the road. We're the pioneers of dashboard publishing. Inside the motorhome. You want to see it?
The Monk Mobile.
Okay, yeah, we do it inside the motorhome.
What happens in there?
What happens there is we write a magazine.
Right.
We write, edit, publish, design, everything you need to do for life on the road as a publisher.
This is the climax of tonight's techno-pagan festivities, the burning of a neon-stripped wicker man.
We're using satellite phones. We're connecting to the internet so that people around the world can watch the burning man
on
in real time.
On their computers.
It's coming through their computer screen, thanks to the cyber monks of Monk the Mobile Magazine.
That's right. It means that computers are meeting burning men in the desert. It means that people painting themselves with mud are meeting high technology, digital cameras. It means that our way of thinking has evolved over the years, where now we're celebrating in the desert, but we're plugged in with lights and cameras.
It's a cultural convergence that really you can't name and claim it yet because we're in the middle of it. We'll know what it is when it's over.
There's some way to go. The courier company failed to deliver the satellite phones, and Monk were forced to postpone their broadcast on the internet till the next day. The technology may not always work, but techno-hippies are convinced that bit by bit, the digital revolution will spread harmony and understanding.
The whole thinking behind Silicon Valley is let's create a technology so everybody can use it and everybody can participate, which is why the whole digital revolution is coming out of San Francisco. Because if you look at all the events of the history of San Francisco, they're all built on inclusivity. The whole summer of love, what is that but an inclusive gathering? What is the Beat Generation but an inclusive thing? What is gay rights but saying, hey, they're equal to us? What is the digital revolution? Everybody can play together. And this really represents the high point of that, because all the different tribes have come together. Tribal, technology, you could come here, because that's what San Francisco is about. And this is San Francisco in microcosm in the desert.
Dawn. And the brave rave on. In the last 6 years, ravers have made melody irrelevant, turned computers into automatic art machines, and learned to be happy without knowing why. The rave new world may be content-free, but where else can you become instant friends with complete strangers?
We normally create friendships. We've made lots of judgments. But this is being friendly to somebody you don't know, no strings attached. Like, I don't care who you are. I'm still going to be as nice as possible, as nice as I can be to you. And it's just a much better way to actually to live.